there is a topic in paper 2, Sociology of Migration. So what this Merrill Van Andel says, education and migration. What happens is, because of migration, the school education is not getting completed. And this has resulted in a vicious cycle of poverty. So at a very young age, people are migrating to the cities. And they are getting cut off from the school education. If you are not able to get the school education, if you are not able to get the skills, then definitely in the globalization with the advent of capitalism, there will be a vicious cycle of poverty. Already Krishna Kumar and N. Jayaram, in their study of educational inequality in Indian society, found that they will form the low wage labor pool. Those migrant population will form a low wage labor pool, as a result of which they will be reproducing poverty. So Marxism is right that the system of economy will eliminate the children from the school education, because poverty compels people to migrate to city. So for earning money, they are migrating to city. 34% of the children, they leave the school before they are completing the 10th standard, and that too without obtaining any certificate. So 34% are dropping out of the school even before completing the 10th standard. And why they are discontinuing from education? Because they are going to become child workers. They are going to add on to the family income because of poverty. 11% of the daughters left the school before reaching class 10, mainly for marriages. So which means that there is a child marriage present. The minimum age of marriage is 18, but at the 10th standard itself, before completing 10th standard itself, girls are leaving the school for getting married, and definitely this will not allow them to develop the intellectual skills needed for earning more money in the industrial economy. So they will not be able to develop the intellectual faculty, as a result of which they will continue to perpetuate poverty, right? Gender and migration. In case of India, gender and migration. What is the impact of migration on women? Migration, every year you get a question in paper 2. So the impact of migration on women is this. There is a study conducted by Saraswati. The urban poor, slum dwellers and the migrants are dispossessed. So there is a dispossession. They are getting dispossessed because of the migration. That there is an urban restructuring, gentrification, that the old buildings will be removed, slums will be cleared. There is a slum clearance board. They'll clear the slum and they'll tell the women, they'll tell the family to get into a, they'll tell the family to get into a new residential complex. Because of which, what and all are the negative consequences is what is the study conducted by Saraswati. The urban poor, slum dwellers and the migrant population, they are subjected to the process of dispossession. In 1990s, it started. After LPG came in 1991, this is becoming very acute, especially in the metropolitan cities, that urban spaces are getting reconstructed, restructured, gentrification process takes place, and there is also an accompanying phenomena called as dispossession. Though the new urban space is giving them certain rights, but however it is depriving them many rights than what it is giving. Fundamental rights is available. Fundamental rights are available according to the Constitution of India. Right to freedom of movement is a fundamental right given under Article 19 only. So even though there is a fundamental right, but these fundamental rights are violated for those who are the victims of this restructuring of the urban spaces. They are not able to participate in the old economic system. They are finding it difficult to get into a new job. And there is a linguistic barrier, there is a cultural difference which is faced by the poor present in the slum area when they have to relocated to a new residential complex, right? So they suffer from cultural deprivation because they have their own subculture. Oscar Lewis is saying that there is present a subculture, but this is a cultural shock which they will be facing because they are exposed to a new urban space. Singh and Vidyarthil in their study found that the existing social relations, they are conflicting with the new forces. So there is always a conflict between the new and the old. There is already present a social relationship, and this social relationship is in conflict with the new forces, novel forces which are developed because of urbanization. So I have my own identity before. Now that old identity comes into conflict with the new identity in the new city. So this is resulting in conflicts between the old and the new identities. Actually speaking, urbanization will have to remove your old identity. It has to replace the old identity by a new identity. But that is not happening. Rather than creating a new identity, actually the old identity is getting rejuvenated. That the survivalists or the revivalists, they speak about this or not. That when you are facing a new, the old gets triggered. So when there is secularization, it is accompanied by sacralization. The more and more when you become modern, the more and more you become tradition. The more and more you become scientific, the more and more you become religious. Understood? So likewise, instead of getting eroded, the historic identities are getting morphed into new identities. New forms of the old identity. There is a concept called as neo-traditionalism. The tradition is changing its form. The tradition is changing its avatar. So neo-traditionalism is making appearance. Hence modernity or urbanization is not eroding the historic identity or the old identity. It is only resulting in new avatars of the old identity. So new forms of old identity is going to emerge, and that what is speaking about identity based movements in cities, right? As we are seeing in the recent times, religiosity is increasing in the cities. Actually speaking, urbanization will have to inculcate an element of scientific element. But today only we are seeing that the Ganesh Chaturthi festival is celebrated with much vigor than before. Cities have become important places in the construction of temples. So more and more temples are coming alongside more and more malls in cities. Right? 90% of those who are displaced because of urbanization, they are working in the informal sector. We know that what is going to happen because of informalization of work. There is a unit, 6th unit in paper 1, where it speaks about the works and economic life. There is a concept which they have spoken about, informalization of work. So 90% of work will be informal work. They will be in informal sector. Informal sector will be deprived of all the social security which is available in the formal sector. So there will be no minimum wage, there will be no safe environment, there will be no provisions which is legally available or constitutionally protected, and that is what is resulting in more and more alienation for the workers left in the informal economic sector. As the capitalism is going to oscillate between the booms and the slums, that they will be more hit because of the recessions. Kosla study 2009 speaks about exclusion and deprivation in cities, because every fifth person is living in slum, and those who are living in the slums, 90% of them are into informal economic sector, and this is resulting in a frustration, or in the terms of Karl Marx, alienation. He is getting dispossessed, he is getting disenchanted, and that is what is the reason for the rise of increasing crime today in cities. If you closely analyze that, there is a close relationship between caste and crime. Caste and crime. There is a big protest which was unfolding after the March 30 Supreme Court verdict on the SC Act, SC ST Act 1989. You have to look at why people have started questioning the judgment of the Supreme Court. Because from the beginning, these lower caste people, they were excluded from the levers of power, status and wealth. They thought that globalization or capitalism will give them a new lease of life. Even Dr. Ambedkar wanted Dalit capitalism, because the possibility of state to immediately correct the structural inequality is highly restricted according to Dr. Ambedkar. So overnight, government cannot change your structural or social structural position. So you have to rely on the market, and that is what is going to help you to come out of the barriers which were imposed in the name of caste system according to Dr. Ambedkar. But what is happening is that continuously, if you compare last 15 years, the crime against SCSTs have increased manifold times. In the last 5 years, conviction rate of non-SCs, of crimes in which non-SCs are victims, they have increased. So crime against non-SCs have reduced. At the same time, those convicted in the crimes committed against non-SCs, the conviction rate is increasing. At the same time, murder of SCs have increased in the last 5 years, and that is coupled by a reduction in the conviction rate. Right? So those who are accused of crime against SCs, mostly they are convicted, mostly they are acquitted. 75% of them are acquitted or they are withdrawing their complaints. Right? So there is an anger which the lower caste people are having today, because the working of capitalism is not breaking the shackles of caste system, rather it is only chaining them more and more. It is only juxtaposing with the already present structural inequality. So which is why Dalits are becoming very conscious of their rights, and hence Dalit mobilization today. If you look at that, the crime against women and children is also increasing in the cities. Right? This has to be seen in the light of how youths are getting dispossessed in the cities. Unemployment, anxiety, poverty, leading to frustration. And that frustration is manifesting in the form of increasing violence against women and children. So, uneven urbanization is only causing more problems than solving. Urbanization was seen by capitalism as a solution for the poverty present in the rural areas. So every modern society or economically modern society wanted to place more number of people in the cities in comparison to villages. But we have seen in India, more and more people have started migrating to cities. But at the same time, one leg is there on the city, one leg of the youth is there on the village, and that is creating a contradiction. That is one of the reason for honor killing, that the boy who is in city is choosing a girl of his choice, resulting in inter-caste marriage, but he is also not severing his ties with the village. And that is how he becomes or she becomes the victim of honor killing. So, anything which is resulting in a combination of opposite forces, that will cause conflict. We have seen this in Marxism when he speaks about unity of opposites or union of opposites. So the problem comes when city is giving you certain rights, that easy transportation is possible in the cities, but at the same time the old community tie is not getting strengthened, it is getting affected. So this is what is the main cause of problems in cities. And when you analyze communal conflict as a city phenomena, you'll understand there is so much of socio-cultural deprivation or the economic deprivation suffered by those marginalized section, and that is the reason for rising religious consciousness and hence fundamentalism, religious revivalism in cities. Right? So Khosla's study also underscores the importance of how deprivation is caused by uneven migration or uneven urbanization. If you carefully look at the demographic profile which accompanies migration, that more and more women will be left in villages, more and more men will be coming to cities. So women will be now burdened with the task of taking care of the family, taking care of the elder, taking care of the sick, taking care of the children, and she will be confined to village. She will have to work in the agricultural sector in order to feed the dependent people in the house, whereas men will migrate to city. So city becomes a place where there is more number of crimes taking place, especially prostitution. Because of the lack of the family support in cities, those migrants are taking up to prostitutions. So that is why urban crimes are increasing. In cities, most of the time you see the public transportation system will be cut by 10, 10:30. Deliberately this is done because the freedom of movement of the people should be restricted as it becomes difficult for maintaining law and order. So city becomes a very difficult place to live because of the restricted space, overcrowding, pollution, tension, traffic congestion. This is the reason for why people in cities are becoming what David Riesman says, lonely crowd. We are like lonely person even though there is a crowd. In the crowd we stand lonely. So this speaks about the exclusion. Similarly, in cities are the migrant women are not homogeneous. Caste differences are there, linguistic differences are there, regional differences are there, religious differences are there. So if you look at those poor women migrants and those who belong to minorities, those who belong to lower caste, there is a superimposition of the identity based on ethnicity, gender, and that is causing more deprivation for such women. So women are not homogeneous, they are heterogeneous. Poor migrant women living in slum, doing domestic work or working as construction worker, they are far more disadvantageous than the women present in the middle class or the upper class in the city. So women, migrant women, poor women, lower caste women, they take up to construction jobs or they work as domestic maids, and their problems are more than that of women belonging to middle caste or middle class and those who are professionals. So that is why differential impact of migration or urbanization on women will have to be studied, as women are not homogeneous, they are heterogeneous. 20% of women in slum area in Mumbai, they suffer from reproductive problems. Example, RTI, reproductive tract infection, and STD, sexually transmitted diseases. 20% of women in slums in Mumbai are affected by RTI, reproductive tract infection, and STD, sexually transmitted diseases. One in every five migrant women, their husband consume alcohol and they are subjected to sexual abuse within the institution of marriage. So one in five women's husband in cities are alcoholic, especially in slum are alcoholic, and these women are facing sexual abuse in the institution, within the institution called marriage, right? So even marital rape, they are the victims of marital rape. So what has to be done? You know, democratization of city governance, political inclusion, right to city for all. So everyone in the city will have to access everything. The buildings will have to promote principles of freedom, gender equality, and human development. So these are the things which has to be done to create a city civic culture. Actually speaking, state came or citizenship came from the concept of city. Greece was organized as a city state, and those who live in the city state, they are given a right called a citizenship right, and since they share the political boundary, they are called as citizens. So city came or citizenship came only from city, and that is why everyone should be accorded equal rights in the city. There should be no exclusion, there should be inclusion. This topic is comparison between Sanskritization and Westernization, which came in a recent article. Functions of Sanskritization and its dynamics with Westernization. What is Sanskritization? It is a way of living, a way of life spread among Hindus. It speaks about the spread of a common culture. That is Sanskritic culture. And M.N. Srinivas is using this concept to speak about caste-based mobility within the social structure, which is rigid. So these are some of the general points related to Sanskritization process. A way of life practiced by Hindus, emergence of a common culture, spread of a common culture, and thirdly, mobility in a rigid form of social stratification. A recent study of Mihir Bole found that there is a conflict between these two models, Sanskritization and Westernization, because Sanskritization is reinforcing the caste-based hierarchy, whereas westernization is dilution of caste based rigidity. When one is reinforcing caste based hierarchy, another is all are following the Brahmins, Sanskritization. Brahmins are following the Western culture, westernization. So these are opposites in nature. One reinforces the caste based hierarchy, the other is diluting the caste based hierarchy, westernization. Barnabas speaks about how, because of industrialization, communication, new occupation, education, which model is becoming very popular, Sanskritization or westernization? Westernization. Because of these changes, westernization is picking up and not Sanskritization. In fact, today you have to be more polluted. Your caste identity should be based on more pollution so that you can claim reservation. So backwardness is what is a benefit. It is giving utility. Next is International Labour Organization's Global Wage Report 2017. How wage inequality is experienced by women. So this topic can be written in Patriarchy and Sexual Division of Labour, which is present in Unit Number 9, Paper 1. Unit Number 5, Social Stratification, Gender as the Basis of Stratification. Then Paper 2, Women's Movement, and Paper 2, Violence Against Women. All these four topics, be written, answer can be written using this data, which is given by the International Labour Organization. Worst level of gender wage disparity in India. Women are earning less than that of men, even though equal wage for equal work for men and women is guaranteed in Article 39. The wage gap between men and women is 30%. If men are given 100 rupees for the same work, women are given only 30 rupees. So wage gap is 30%. So there is a choice which women make, which influences to this. Women's educational choices has resulted in reproduction of this gender gap. For example, women prefer to become teacher, women prefer to become nurse. So nursing, especially taking care of the elderly, they are not seen as a skilled job. That is why it is unpaid. Nursing profession is overrepresented. Women are overrepresenting the nursing profession. Why? Because culturally, women are providing this role, or she is acting, performing this role called as nursing, taking care of the family. And nursing is not equated with skill. Taking care of house, doing 56 types of unpaid work at house, not seen as skilled. So nursing is not skill. Care work given by women is not treated as skill. Rather, it is treated only as an attribute of women. Nursing job is not seen as a skilled job. It is only seen as the attribute of women. So, gendered division of labor or pink collar jobs, this can be written. High income inequality is present in India. According to ILO, International Labour Organization, top 1% earned 33% than that of the bottom 10%. Comparing bottom 10% with that of the top 1%, top 1% earned 33 times more than that of the bottom 10%. So high income inequality. Already we have spoken about World Inequality Report 2018. From that also you can take points for talking about inequality in income. Top 10% earned 43% of all wages. Out of total wages, 43% of the wages earned only by top 10%. Since 2006, the average wage rose by 60% in India, while in case of China, the average wage raised by 2 times than that of India. So the average rise in the wage in India is only half of that of than that of the China, right? So wage rise is very much slow in comparison to China. Our wage rise is 60% since 2006, and their wage rise is 120%. High income inequality in comparison to China. Next topic is citizenship. In the Polity and Society topic, unit number 7, you have this citizenship. So as you have paper 2, Polity and Society topic, where there is present citizenship, the study is conducted in Bangalore or Bengaluru. This study clearly tells that there is no effective citizenship for people belonging to lower caste or people belonging to Muslim community in comparison to those present in the upper class or middle class or Hindu religion. So effective citizenship, whether it is present for all, whether it is availed by all in city, is the study. So this is a study based in Bangalore. What is the percentage of urbanization? 1951, 17.3% of the population lived in city. Only 5 Indian cities had a population more than 1 million each. But today you see, Mumbai, Delhi, Calcutta is having 1 crore plus population, and there are 53 cities having population more than 1 million each. So only 3 cities had 1 million, 5 cities have 1 million plus population in 1951. 2011, 53 cities have population more than 1 million. So more number of people present in cities today. According to United Nations report in 2012, it says that 40% of people will be in city in India in the next 15 to 20 years. Next 2 decades, the percentage of urbanites in the total population will be 40%. Today it is 30%. And in next 5 year, 10 year from 2012, it will become 40%. So 40% of 1.2 billion people will be living, and by that time 1.2 also will increase by 2025 or 2020. For the first time, 2011 census says the absolute increase in the urban population. First time this census has reported absolute increase in the urban population exceeded than that of the rural population. The absolute increase in the urban population in the last 10 years, the absolute number of people who are belonging to village, the absolute number of people who are belonging to city, when compared, number of people added to city increased than that of the number of people added to villages. And this is the first time we are seeing a trend that the absolute number of the city people have crossed the absolute number of the village people in the last 10 years. So more and more people are adding on to cities. But the question comes, are they enjoying a qualitative and effective citizenship rights in these cities? The answer is negative. The largest survey took place in Bengaluru. In this survey, it was found that citizens of Bangalore, they vote large in number, but beyond voting, they are not actively participating in politics. More number of people are voting, but nothing more than voting takes place in the realm of politics. So their representation in politics is very much restricted only to voting. This is also reflecting the weak panchayats or the weak local bodies. The ground is not strong. The grassroots democracy is not strong in Bangalore. It reflects low level formal institution for engaging in politics. So local bodies are not performing as per expectation. Effective citizenship is highly differentiated. Even though people of Bangalore know that they have a formal right, but their capacity to use this formal right is very much unevenly distributed. You can see higher class have greater effective citizenship in comparison to lower class. So their politics, higher class is involving in politics more effectively, not just confining to election. They are acting as strong pressure groups. But the lower class people, though especially Dalit people, vote in more numbers, but they are not able to participate in politics beyond voting. Upper class can constitute a pressure group, not the lower caste. Right? But however, the highest class, highest class, according to the survey, those topmost class, those richest people, they are not bothered about even voting. So high class is effectively using their citizenship right. Highest class is not using because they are not bothered about voting. Lower class is voting in large number, but they are not having citizenship right. They are not using because they are poor, because they are illiterate, and they don't have the influence so that they can constitute a pressure group and take part in the decision making. So this is what the trend. Caste and religious differences are noted in the enjoyment of effective citizenship. Dalits and Muslims have low level of effective citizenship than non-Dalits and Hindus. So Dalits are not effectively using their citizenship in comparison to non-Dalits, Hindus and Christians. So there is a general pattern of differentiated citizenship, that it is based on caste, it is based on ethnicity. Right? So they don't have appropriate knowledge to use their citizenship, which is why Plato and all spoke about why universal adult franchise should not be given in the first go. Plato and Aristotle wanted those people who are, you know, in the lowermost part of the society. First of all, they should be taught about the citizenship right, then only they can be given voting right. If you give voting right to people without knowing the value of the vote, then what will happen is they will start selling the vote only. And that is what is happening in India. That if you are not making people conscious of the value of the vote, they will sell the vote. Right? So Dalits, Muslims, they are not having education, as Rajinder Sachar committee equates both of them. Dalits and scheduled castes are, Dalits and Muslims are almost equal in their social status with respect to political participation also. So effective citizenship is missing. In case of voting, lower class Dalits and Muslims, they participate large in number, but their participation is confining only to election, to voting, nothing more than that. Access to infrastructure is highly unevenly distributed. So they are not able to get education, sanitation, drinking water, a clean living environment. those belonging to minorities and that of Dalits. So it is not just to be seen isolatedly that they are not able to enjoy the effective citizenship. It has to be seen connected to the differentiated access to the infrastructure. Right? So this is interconnected. No access to social infrastructure, less knowledge about voting or less knowledge about the value of vote, less effective citizenship or no effective citizenship. They are confining their political action only to voting. So caste, religion, gender and all influences to effective citizenship. Women, Muslims, Dalits, Adivasis, they are very less effective in comparison to men, Hindu, OBC, upper caste and middle and upper class. Class difference is present, ethnic differences is present, in fact tribal difference, caste difference, class difference, gender difference, all the differences are present. Women, Muslims, Dalits, scheduled tribes, they are not able to effectively use their citizenship right in comparison to men, Hindus, middle class, upper class, middle caste, dominant caste, upper caste. Chatterjee says citizenship is the preserve of the elites. It is the preserve of the elites. Whereas Yadav says poor and the lower caste are more active electorally than that of the rich and the upper caste. So the poor people go to the voting, whereas rich people don't even bother about elections. This is what is tallying with what Karl Marx says, that if you have economic power, you can have political power. If you are economically dominating, you can control the levers of the state power. Right? So poor are electorally active than the rich, according to Yadav, whereas Chatterjee says that they are, citizenship is the preserve of the rich people, elite people. Next topic is tribal integration in a democratic society. What are the problems which is faced while integrating the tribes to the larger society? There is a topic in paper to tribal policies. And these tribal policies have been asked many times in the examination. So something which came in the recent articles in the journals on tribal integration and the problems in a democratic society is worth mentioning. Roy Berman speaks about integration of the tribes. He says it is a historical necessity. Tribal integration with the nation is a historical necessity designed for the progress of the tribes, for the tribes to become progressive. They are required to be integrated with the national mainstream society. This is sharply contradicting to Verrier Elvin's national park approach or isolation approach. However, integration is not a uniform model. There is no single model of integration. And integration per se will not lead to progress. It depends upon how well they are integrated with the mainstream society. Whether they are entering into the caste-based system or they are accepting to the caste system as superordinate, subordinate, whether they are completely merging, assimilation, whether they are accepting to the superiority of the caste culture. So a number of such questions needs to be answered. It is a historic necessity that the tribes will have to be integrated. But however, integration per se is not leading to progress, because there are varieties of models of integration. There are different layers or levels of integration. So you have to develop an ideal type model. It is not a singular theory, a deterministic theory. Develop ideal types. A number of models of tribal integration possible. We have to ensure that we need to focus on the psychological and the sociological aspects of integration. Because the psychology of the tribes will have to be studied. So as the culture of the tribes will have to be taken into account when you are suggesting an integration model. And we also will have to focus on the modes of integration or the techniques of integration. How they are integrated into the mainstream culture. While integrating them, have you taken care of the psychological and the social well-being of the tribes? That has to be seen. So when you have to plan scientifically to integrate the tribe with the mainstream culture, you have to ensure two things: psychological, social aspect of tribal integration, and secondly, whether the techniques of integration is appropriate to them, because there are many, many models of integration. There is one Weiss or Weiss. He says there are four patterns of tribal integration. There are four models of tribal integration according to Weiss, W-I-E-S-E. One is sub and superordination. Number two, second model is socialization. Third model is uniformalization or uniformization. Fourth model is liberation. These are the four models of tribal integration according to Weiss. So which one will be better? A.K. Roy Berman says liberation will be better. So the liberation model will have to be used for tribal integration. Because superordination, subordination means what? You will be integrated as inferior. Tribes will be integrated as inferiors. And the inferiors always will be exploited. Right? Socialization means what? You are training them in such a way that you are accepting, they are accepting your culture. Roy Berman says, this should not be there. The first model should not be there. Rather, there should be coordination of the social entities. Social entities means tribes and caste. Coordination rather than subordination. He says, socialization also should not be there. Rather than socialization, because socialization means the tribes are accepting to the standard culture of the caste. And they are asking many times caste tribal integration, policies of tribe, policies of tribal policy they are asking. And secondly, they are asking another question, how tribe and caste is related to each other. Tribe and caste continuum is an important short notes for every year. So he says we should not go for socialization, because socialization leads to the tribes conforming to the caste culture. Rather, we should go for harmonization. He says uniformization should be replaced by a technical term which he is using, covariation of standardized behavior. Covariation of standardized behavior, which means that when you are integrating, you are allowing the tribes to retain their cultural elements. Adhu dhaan covariation, right? Covariation is opposite to assimilation. Assimilation means completely you are merging. Covariation, means you are allowing them to remain independent. Even though you are coming closer with the caste, the independence of the tribes will be protected. I am making this simple because it is very, very conceptually loaded things which is suggested by Weiss. So what is the suggestion which Roy Berman says is, rather than uniformization, we have to go for co-variation of standardized behavior. Simply, you listen to what I am saying, because if you write this thing, you may get confused. Simple point, I am simplifying it. Allow them to get integrated. Let them maintain their distinct identity. That is what is standardized behavior. And liberation is another method. Liberation means satisfy the spiritual need of the individuals. Because tribes will have some spiritual needs. You have to satisfy the spiritual needs of the tribes. So liberation, uniformization, socialization, super subordination. These are the four types of tribal integration suggested by Weiss. Roy Berman is making an assessment and he is making a correction. Superordination, subordination should be rejected. Secondly, socialization should be replaced by harmonization. Thirdly, uniformization should be replaced by co-variation of standardized behavior. Fourthly, liberation is acceptable because it takes into account the spiritual need of the tribes. Because tribes have more and more magico-animistic religion. Unlike caste, which will have a great religion, tribes will have magico-animistic religion. They more and more believe in the power of spirit. And the spiritual quest of the tribes will have to be protected in the process called liberation. So liberation as a method of integration is acceptable to Roy Berman also. What we have to do, you know, we have to synthesize their cultural symbols with the cultural symbols of the nation. And secondly, there is a need for social reform. Their cultural symbols should be integrated with the national cultural symbols. And secondly, social reforms. These are the two things which has to be done for tribal integration. Integrate tribal symbols with that of the national symbols. For example, in the history textbook, the NCERT, there is no document about the tribal protest becoming the foundation stone for national movement. But if you introduce a uniform curriculum, make the tribal children learn the history book, NCERT history book, where their heroes are not adequately present, then they become distanced from the universal curriculum. And what are the skill which they have to possess to live in their culture? That has to be given training. That training will have to be given to them. So if you want everyone to become an engineer or a doctor, then definitely they will get disconnected from the mainstream. So you have to harmonize them. More and more tribal heroes will have to be written in the NCERT textbook. So one line you study about tribal revolution. More and more you see only the presence of national leaders. No adequate importance given to the tribal leaders in the curriculum. Similarly, what is the curriculum of the mainland society? That is different from that of the felt needed curriculum of the tribal society. So you have to do this thing. that the tribal symbols will have to be integrated with the national symbol, and there has to be a social reform, because people have an imagination about the tribe, they have an assumption about the tribe, the general population, that the tribe don't tally with the cult of the modern man. So they are seen as primitives, right? So that mindset will have to change. Supreme Court of India was putting a ban on tourism in the Jarawa area, because the mainland people are going to see Jarawas as they are going to see animals in the zoo. So this set of complex which is present, an ethnocentric feeling which is present with the mainstream culture, will have to go, for which there is a need for social reform. So that is why we say modification of attitude and social engineering. Just read what is given in the blue color. Modification of the attitude and interest. And number two, social engineering. Bureaucracy, civil society, social scientists will have to work together to contribute for, to trigger social engineering. So with enlightened civil servants, with active involvement of civil society and social scientists, social engineering should have to be effected. Then only the problems of the tribes will disappear. Jyoti Mai Sharma, in her study of West Bengal village, found that those who are in the bottommost of the caste ranking, they are consciously wanting to improve their living, and their improvement is acknowledged by the people also. So she, in her study of West Bengal village, found mobility present in the caste system. Caste at the bottom make a conscious effort to move up, and their desire for status changes recognized by the rest of the community. For example, there are some groups who are doing a polluting job, like removing the dead animal. They wanted to improve their standing. They don't do that job. There is a vacuum created in the division of labor, and that vacuum will be filled by another caste group which is not traditionally removing the dead animal. Right? So this is what we are saying. These lower caste people, Sanskritization, give up the unclean jobs. For example, Jyoti Mai Sharma speaks about Muchis in West Bengal. They are the one who will clear the dead animal. They are working in the leather, and they have left this job because they wanted to experience upward mobility. Now what is happening is, there is a vacuum, there is a gap in the division of labor, because they told we will not remove the dead animal as we are going to sanskritize. Now what happens, Gons or Orans and Santals, they are doing this job today, even though their job is not removing the dead animal. Orans and Santals, they are not traditionally into the job of removing the dead animal. However, because this Muchis have left, the job, it has to be filled by Santals and Orans. Roy Berman says there cannot be a single pattern, there cannot be a single model of tribal integration. You cannot have a rigid pattern of tribal integration. It is context dependent. So we will not accept what Verrier Elwin says. We will also not accept what G.S. Gore says. Neither assimilation of G.S. Gore nor isolation of Verrier Elwin. Roy Berman says tribal integration will have to be studied based on the context. Next topic is power elite in rural India. A study of K.L. Sharma. Power elite in rural India. A study by K.L. Sharma. K.L. Sharma says, elites are not homogeneous group, they are heterogeneous. Brahmins are heterogeneous, Kshatriyas are heterogeneous, Vaishyas are also heterogeneous. He is rejecting the concept of dominant caste. Given by Srinivas. In some areas, there is a caste which influences. In some areas, there is a family which is influencing. So there is no single domination, single type of domination. Some aspects of social life is controlled by a group. Some other aspect of social life is controlled by family or individuals. So dominant caste theory of M.N. Srinivas says what? One caste or a group of caste which is numerically preponderant, which is having land access, they will influence the society. But actually this K.L. Sharma says no. Some aspects group is influencing. Some aspects of social life family is influencing. Some other aspects of social life, individual influences. So the rural elite, they are not homogeneous, they are heterogeneous. So they don't have the characteristic of a group at all, because they don't have commonality of interest. They don't have equal economic standing. They don't have equal political standing also. Hence, elites are not to be called as a rural power elites are not to be called as a group in itself, because there are too many differences among them. There is so much of fragmentations. Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas. Brahmins are cultural groups, Kshatriyas are administrative groups, Vaishyas are business community. But however, Brahmins as a group, they don't have unity. There are sub caste present within Brahmins. Subcaste present within Kshatriyas and that of Vaishyas. So don't say that one single group is going to dominate. There are differences within the same group, and the group character itself is not missing, because they have different interest, they have different economic standing, they have different political ambition. Next topic is regions within regions. A study conducted by Ashutosh Kumar. Regionalization of Indian polity is a phrase which is used by Ashutosh Kumar. This you can write in regionalism. There is a topic in paper 2, regionalism. You can use this Ashutosh Kumar's concept of regionalization of Indian polity. Regionalization of Indian polity. You can see that there are many identities today. The identity may be caste, religion, language, region, etc., etc. Multiple identities are present. Now, what globalization has done is, it has sharpened the identity differences. Identity already is present, but it has only sharpened the identity differences. So, representative democracy has sharpened the line of distinction between groups. And those who are very dormant before, now they are becoming very active. Like the dormant volcano becomes an active volcano, those sections of the society which were very dormant politically, today they are trying to assert their identity. So, hitherto dormant communities are trying to influence, they are trying to make their voices heard by mobilizing their support. Montek Singh Aluwalia, Atul Kohli and Kurian, all of them have spoken about how economic reforms have resulted in increasing voices of the regions. The process of regional politics have received a great impetus because of economic reforms. So after LPG, regional politics have become very stronger, according to Kurian, Aluwalia and Atul Kohli. Many peripheral groups, marginal groups, they find that due to regionalism or regional politics, the center is withdrawing and the regional groups are becoming very stronger today. Regionalization of politics resulting in center withdrawing. The central government is withdrawing and the state is now left to the regional parties. So it is very much needed that you have to conduct politics based on your identity. Because earlier there was, you know, till 1967, there was present a central government and the state government and central government belong to the same party. But with the regionalization, regional political parties becoming stronger since 1960s, that the center is moving away from the state and the state is now left to the regional parties. That is why you can see Telangana movement. That is why you are seeing Vidarbha movement, Kodagu movement, Bundelkhand movement, Bodoland movement. And these movements are becoming very active after LPG. Market economy privileges the privileged. So you may be a social group or you may be a region. It only privileges the privileged. Market economy is only privileging the privileged. May it be social group or region. For example, the coastal regions are becoming very prosperous compared to that of the non-coastal regions. Right? Tamil Nadu is much advancing than that of the states like Bihar or UP or Rajasthan or West Bengal. Coastal states have become high income states and they are benefited by LPG. Whereas those peripheral states, they are not privileged. They continue to remain privileged despite of globalization. So, we can see the Telangana movement is a fitting case. That all the developmental benefits or the fruits of globalization went to Simandhra region, excluding the Telangana people. And that is the reason for Telangana movement to become very stronger. So globalization has only accelerated regionalization of politics. Regional inequalities are widening. Interstate inequality, intrastate disparity have become very faster. Right? So interstate disparity, intrastate disparity, regional inequality becoming more stronger after economic liberalization. Next topic is problems of multiculturalism. So what is happening in a multicultural society? What are the problems faced by people in a multicultural society? Walker Coroner or Connors, Walker Connors, he says, when this ethnic identity will get revived, when your cultural identity will get revived, when constitutional promises are not met, then naturally ethnic identity will get stronger. So ethnic nationalism is a consequence of non-fulfillment of the constitutional promises. Ethnic nationalism is an outcome of non-fulfillment of the constitutional promises. So ethno-nationalism in the topic called polity and society, either paper 1 or paper 2. You have the concept called as nation or nationalism, and you can write this. Walker Connors, there is more and more ethno-nationalism when constitutional promises are unmet. Cultural nationalism conflicts with constitutional nationalism, leading to structural change or structural strain and then social conflict. Strain theory, we know, R.K. Merton speaks about this strain theory. When there is a disequilibrium, when there is strain, when the strain is increasing beyond the resilience, there is a need for functional alternative, according to R.K. Merton. Similarly, cultural nationalism conflicts with constitutional nationalism, and that leads to strain, and strain is manifested in the form of social conflict. So today, the beef ban are trying to suppress the right to freedom of expression, more and more attempting a blanket ban on freedom of expression, or more and more surveillance, more and more restrictions on in the freedom of speech, invoking the sedition law. They are all the outcomes of the strain present in the society. John Stuart Mill says that a uniform culture is next to impossible in a culturally pluralistic society. And in a society characterized by linguistic diversity, uniform culture is certainly impossible. When there is a cultural pluralism, there is no uniform culture, or uniform culture is next to impossible in a culturally pluralistic society. And in a linguistically diversified society, single culture or uniform culture is certainly impossible. We have linguistic diversity. 1,632 languages are spoken by 90% of the population. 90% of India speak 1,632 languages. So in a linguistically diversified society, a uniform culture is certainly impossible, according to John Stuart Mill. And that is the reason why people of Tamil Nadu, they protested very strongly when Hindi was introduced compulsorily. Linguistic diversity, language is not just a medium of communication of your ideas or exchange of ideas. Rather, language is a cultural system. Language speaks about the history of the community. Language is an organism. It is a whole which is made up of parts which are interconnected and interdependent. So that is why language is coming closer to the heart of every individual. And that is why you call your language as a mother language or mother tongue. You don't call your religion as a mother religion or your caste as a mother caste. You only call language as mother tongue. So that speaks about the importance of language. So when you have linguistic diversity, there cannot be any attempt to forge a cultural uniformity, and that will only backfire. It happened in case of Tamil Nadu. The linguistic nationalism, which emerged as a bigger threat to the national unity, was diluted because of the Dravidian party able to form the government in the state. Right? We also know Steve Bruce says, religious fundamentalism becomes very stronger when the religious groups are not able to find their political root in the political system. If the door is closed for them to enter politics, religious groups, if find that the door to political entry is closed, they'll become violent. So their aspiration will have to find expression. The religious group's aspiration will have to find a political expression. If not, violence will result. And that typically speaks about the rising Hindutva wave in Indian society. Herbert Marcuse, who writes One Dimensional Man, he says, tolerance is the main reason which will not allow you to apply reason. In the name of tolerance, what is eroded is reason is eroded. So this is what he is basically influenced by Marxism and Weber. Herbert Marcuse is highly indebted or is highly intellectually influenced by Marx and Weber. You have to tolerate. Tolerance is a value present in Indian society. That is what is the understanding that many people have spoken about the culture of tolerance present in India. But Herbert Marcuse says, in the name of tolerance, you don't apply your mind. Tolerance is to hide reason. You tolerate. When you tolerate, what you are not exercising, reason is not exercised. Autonomy of individual is not exercised. So tolerance is erosion of individual autonomy. Tolerance is erosion of reason. So tolerance is unreasonable according to Herbert Marcuse. Herbert Marcuse is using a concept like Althusser. We know Althusser used the concept called as ideological conditioning. There is an ideological state apparatus, there is a repressive state apparatus according to Althusser. Education, mass media, by persuading you, they'll make you accept the values of capitalism. Repressive state apparatus, police, law court, will punish you, make you accept the values of the capitalism. So state is having two apparatus. One coercion called repressive state apparatus, one persuasion called as ideological state apparatus. Ideological conditioning is a term which is used by Althusser. Similarly, this Herbert Marcuse is using a concept called as systemic moronization. Moronization, systemic moronization. So instead of ideological conditioning, he is using the concept called as systemic moronization by propaganda and publicity. That is why more and more publicity will be made by the party in power. Big, big advertisements. According to one report, it says 4,300 crores the government has spent on advertisement. Close to 5,000 crore on advertisement alone. So, through advertisement, they are making you, persuading you, accept the culture of the dominant, politically or economically. Moronization, systemic moronization of children and adult, alike by publicity and propaganda. Right? So, you can use this in Marxism. You can use this in Marxism. Moronization, the concept. Education spread is uneven. And you know that the public culture demands you to be constantly present offline, online. Every time you have to keep your cell phone on. You have to get connected. If you are not putting a comment for the posting which comes in your WhatsApp, they'll ask you, are you alive only? So constantly you have to make your presence felt, both online as well as offline. That is the demand of the public culture. If you are not liking sharing, commenting constantly, and not a part of what just went viral, you are deemed without any identity. So there may be a possibility of a question called as sociology of social media. What is sociology of social media? Denmark, sociology of WhatsApp. These are the things which you have to write. Popular culture demands, always you should be present online, offline. So if you are not liking anything which is trending, then you are having no identity. Like Rohingyas who don't have identity, they have to seek refuge. Those people who don't have identity, if they are not commenting, they will have no identity and they will become refuge. Not in the real world, but in the virtual world. So we become a refuge. This also can be continued in this topic, the illusion of participation, social media. Illusion of participation. Are you participating? You are not participating, you are simply following. You are not participating, you are following. Following is not participating. Participating means act. You should be very active, you should be taking part in the decision making. That is what is participation. This is no participation, you are just following. The illusion of participation. Harold Innes writes about Facebook in 1951 in his book called as Bias of Communication. He says that Facebook is a very powerful political media. He makes a comment, he has already written a book in 1951, Bias of Communication, Harold Innes. There are two types of sources of information. One is fastly moving, another is very slowly moving. For example, one which is inscribed in the stones, one which is manuscript, one which is orally recited. The chance of them to spread is very little. Because you have to go to the rock inscription to see what is written. You have to go to Mahabalipuram to see the rocks, to see the scriptures, to understand what is written. This is one type of information. Another type of information is social media information through internet, which moves tremendously fastly. So there are two types of informations. One, fast information like internet information. Another is very slow information like that of the rock inscriptions or the manuscripts or the orally stored stories. What is happening in the second type, the fastly moving information? That fastly moving information will have to be validated by you many times. Have you ever thought about that the same WhatsApp joke which you have seen before 1 year came today? The same story, say same rumor which was there before 1 year will come again. Because in this case of internet, since it is very fast, it reaches many people, many such information reaches many people, every information to get registered will have to be sent repeatedly. So that is why again and again you will be getting a joke which you already know, which already you have laughed. Second time if you read the same joke, you should not laugh like first time. Third time if you read the same joke, fourth time you read the same joke, you laugh heavily like first time, then there is a problem in the hippocampal fiber. They have not stored the joke. Hippocampal fiber is there which stores all these informations. It is not there. Properly it is not working. So this any empire which has to balance these two, fastly moving information and slowly moving information, they are going to a high order progressive civilization. They are the one which are very progressively civilized, the fast moving information. So you can't leave everything to internet, and you can't deny internet and focus only on inscription, like it is very authentic information. I'll cut the stone, I'll inscribe my joke onto the rock so that people will go see the rock, get the joke, laugh. This Harold Innis speaks about this, the balancing of fast moving information and slow moving information results in the civilizational advancement. Newspaper, radio, television, they reach out to vast territories, but the content or the message will not last long. That is why it has to be repeatedly given. It has to be many times, it has to be repeatedly given. The repetition of information through internet is necessary, because otherwise we forget. Empires which were able to develop a balance between these two, fast moving information and slow moving information, they attain higher civilizational goals. They attain higher civilizational goals. Internet and mobile phone reach extraordinarily wide and fast, but the messages conveyed to them needs relentless repetition. So that is why it is not uncommon when you get the same joke after 2 years or 3 years. Social media creates an illusion of maximal participation, but actually it is not participation, it is only following. The millions who are following the leader, they are not participating in decisions. So just when you are active in the social media does not mean that you are actively participating in decision making. Follower is not a decision maker. We just follow. We just follow. We don't take any decisions. So this is about sociology of mass media or social media. Democracy and gendered leadership. So you can write this in democratic decentralization, a topic which is present in paper 2, or you can write in women's movement, violence against women, gender as the base of stratification, patriarchy. So anything related to women, you can write this. Anything related to political participation or decentralization, you can write this. A study conducted by Niranjana in 2003. Seemandini Niranjana study 2003. Women's participation in formal politics. What is the status of women's participation in formal politics and how they are participating in movements? There are two types of political participation. One is you participate in politics directly, formal institutions like party, like government, like panchayat raj institution. The other type of participation is you participate in movements. For example, many of the movements, you have women participation, especially in the environmental movement like TIPCO movement, right? You have women's participation in anti-Iraq movement. So political participation is of two types. One is formal, second is movement. Anuradha Datta 2008 study of women in insurgency movements, women participation in insurgency movement in Assam. there is one called All Bodo Women Federation. It is an identity based movement. All Bodo Women Welfare Federation is an identity based movement. Subsequently, they have started working for environmental protection. So they wanted today sustainable peace. Earlier it was an insurgent movement, today it has become a peace movement. They wanted sustainable peace. Insurgent movement became peace movement today. In Northeast India, there are two types of political system. One is traditional political system, another is modern political system. Even though it appears that the tribal societies are equalitarian, but actually speaking, there is present gender-based inequality in tribal society. When you write caste-tribe comparison in paper 2 or tribe-caste continuum in paper 2, you can write this. Like there is present patriarchy in caste system, there is also present patriarchy in tribal societies. So caste and tribe, they are not opposites of each other. Rather, every caste is only a tribe. First people were tribes, then they became caste. The traditional political system never recognized the political right of women. Only modern political system in Northeast India increased the women's participation in politics, PRI. So traditional system never recognized women as primary decision makers in case of ethnic crisis, crisis management, social sanction, etc. Hence, traditional political system is patriarchal in nature, even in tribal society in Northeast India. Modern democratic system is increasing women's participation. We have seen how percentage of women participation increased after PRIs. It was 4 to 5% women participation before PRI. After PRI came, women participation in politics, formal politics, increased to 25 to 40%. So, the sheer number of women participating in the formal political system has increased because of 73rd Amendment Act. So, traditional political system is patriarchal. Modern political system is causing gender equality by increasing the participation of women in politics. Hazarika studies how there are many obstacles for women participation in PRI. What are the obstacles women face while they participate in Panchayat Raj institution? Household work is a burden. Lack of community support, lack of financial support, lack of political consciousness, cultural barrier, educational poverty, and patriarchy. These are the barriers for women participation in politics, even in tribal society. So we cannot agree what anthropologists have said, that tribal societies are equalitarian society. There is present inequality even in the tribal society. According to Sujata Hazarika's study, barriers for women's participation in PRI: burden of household work, lack of family and community support, financial support, lack of political consciousness, cultural barrier, educational poverty, and patriarchy in decision making. These are the problems or barriers for women participation in PRI in Northeastern India. Sujata Hazarika study. So there is a portrayal of egalitarian social structure, but there is a discrimination, right? There is a fear of ostracism, especially in Bodos. Women face the fear of getting outcasted, ostracized, if they deviate from the cultural values. So women of Bodo tribe face ostracism if they are deviating from the entrenched cultural values. Next is Panchayat Raj and democratic politics. M.N. Srinivas says there is a clan and kin based political organization in the rural areas. Politics was centering around kinship and clan, right? Because parties were not there in the rural areas. So rural political structure is centering around caste and clan. Srinivas speaks about caste panchayats, and there is also a saying that caste is an extended kin. Iravadi Karve. Iravadi Karve speaks, gives this statement. Iravadi Karve says this, that caste is an extended kinship system. Iravadi Karve statement, caste is an extended kinship group. So political system was organizing around centering around the kin groups, because party is not present. When you move from village to a district, in the village more number of agrarian community will be participating in PRI. But when you go to district, the number of participants in PRI coming from agricultural community reduces. So what is the impact of fall in the number of agrarian communities in PRI participation? Decision centering around or decision pertaining to agriculture will not be taken. And this is not good for agriculture or not. So when agricultural groups don't have adequate representation in the district level governance, they are more represented in the village panchayat. But when you go to the district level, when you go to Zilla Panchayat, there is no adequate number of representatives of the agrarian workforce, and that suffers. That leads to sufferings of the agricultural community. So when you move up above, bottommost layer, agricultural community more participating. When you move above to district level, agrarian representatives are not present. So the decisions which may positively impact agricultural community is not getting taken. It is not taken at all, and that is causing agricultural distress. Non-agrarian rich sections are participating in PRI in the district level. So agricultural development suffers. Nagaland's tribal democracy. Nagaland's tribal democracy. More studies centering around relation between caste and politics. Very less studies on tribe and politics. More studies available on caste politics. Less study available on tribal politics. Andre Bethe makes a statement. Across India, loyalty to family, loyalty to kin, loyalty to community override party ideology. So there is nothing called ideology. There is only called affiliation. You have an affiliation towards the leaders, personal bonding with the leader. There is nothing like ideology. So definitely that is why the charismatic leaders will always be attracting the masses. Nothing like ideology. Nothing called ideology. Andrebethesis. What is more important? My personal affiliation with the leader. I cherish the leader. Or kinship. Or family bonding. Or community bonding. Nothing like ideology. Ideology is not a relevant factor to be taken into consideration. Ideology, if you give importance to, then naturally you will be more and more into this leftist or rightist parties. So Indian political scene is governed by personal loyalties of the leaders and the followers. அதனால தான் ஐடியாலஜி எல்லாம் தேவையில்லை. இப்போ நோ நீடு ஃபார் ஐடியாலஜி. ஐடியாலஜி அப்படின்னா லெப்டிஸ்ட் ரைட்டிஸ்ட், லெப்டிஸ்ட் கம்யூனிஸ்ட விட ஒரு ஐடியாலஜி தேவையா? யூ நீ நாட் ஹாவ் எனி ஐடியாலஜி மோர் தென் தட் ஆஃப் தி கம்யூனிஸ்ட் ஐடியாலஜி, பட் தர் இஸ் நோ டேக்கர் ஃபார் கம்யூனிஸ்ட் பார்ட்டி இன் தமிழ்நாடு ஆர் ஈவன் நேஷனல் லெவல் யூ கேன் சி, எக்ஸப்ட் கேரளா அண்ட் வெஸ்ட் பெங்கால். அண்ட் ஈவன் இன் வெஸ்ட் பெங்கால் தே ஆர் டிஸ்பிளேஸ்டு பை திரிணாமுல் காங்கிரஸ். So ideology is secondary, affiliation is primary. Voting choices are dependent on the prevailing social structures, the sentiments of the people. So that is why the party symbol works. Traditionally you are voting to one particular party. Grandfather voted to a particular party, father voted to a particular party, and the son will also vote to the same party. Because the pre-existing voting behavior influences you. Right? In a democratic system, many may influence politics. Language may influence politics. Right? Parties may influence politics. So you have the identity which is more and more becoming stronger in the political arena. Identity based politics. Affiliation based politics. No ideology based politics. Of course, certain old types of hierarchies were displaced. Certain old types of hierarchies were displaced. But however, identity is also getting revived. Old structures are displaced. Certain areas, old inequalities have disappeared in democracy. But at the same time, social relationship also becomes politicized. So India is not transforming into a nation which is giving equal rights to all. Some places, the old hierarchies have vanished. But in other places, old hierarchy is still present. There is a political relationship. There is a politicization of the old social relationship. And this phenomena that democracy can only dismantle certain elements of old inequalities, not able to dismantle a vast majority areas of inequality, resulting in how democracy is not able to transform, the democratic project is not able to transform Indian society drastically. So, if you use Parsonian language, structural change is not present. Change in structure is present, not change of structure. Partially changes are there, not complete changes. Some elements of old hierarchy continues. some elements of old hierarchy disappeared. So continuation of inequality and disappearance of certain inequalities, resulting in democracy not able to transform Indian society, which can give equal rights to all irrespective of their primordial identity or ascriptive identity. In Nagaland, ideology is not working. Study of Nagaland politics says that ideology is very deceptive in nature. Ideology is not working. So, Nagaland politics is non-ideological in character. Non-ideological in character. According to Amer study, A-M-E-R, study 2014. In Nagaland, there was one unique situation where for a brief period of time, Congress and BJP had a coalition. Nowhere it is present in the country except Nagaland. That for a brief period of time, Congress and BJP came together supporting a coalition. So what is important? Ideology is not important. Cross-carpeting means cross-flooring, cross-voting. This side people will switch from this side to that side. So there is so much of defection, no ideology. And there was a coalition for a brief period of time between BJP and Congress in Nagaland. You cannot use ideology to study the internal working of politics. Ideology cannot explain the internal dynamics of democracy. Ideology cannot explain the internal dynamics of democracy. So actually, which party will be preferred, you know? The party which is favoring its own men will be preferred than a party which is not favoring its men. So any party which comes to power in Nagaland ensures that much of the government fund is benefiting their group rather than the other group. So there is nothing called ideology. Are you promoting the interest of your people? Are you diverting the state resources to cater to the interest of your people? If you are diverting the resources of the state to cater to the interest of your people, in the next election you will be voted. Otherwise, you will not be voted. So there is nothing like ideology in politics. Andhra says, and Nagaland study also indicated that ideology is not working in. Actually, ideology cannot explain the internal dynamics present in democracy. Political judgments are made. It will praise only those people who are serving their own people, and they will fail. The government will not be getting elected next time if you are not serving your people. So what is important is how much you have transferred the wealth of the government to your people. That's all. There is nothing like ideology. Lucia Michelotti says, candidates are chosen based on caste arithmetic in UP. Not only in UP, this is present in all country, all states. Lucia says that caste-based arithmetic decides the choice of the candidates by the party. Even in Tamil Nadu, in Karnataka or Telangana, wherever you go in Madhya Pradesh, every part of the country, party is choosing the candidate based on the voters' profile, caste profile of the voters. So, which constituency is having which caste groups as numerically majority, candidate will be chosen from that majority caste community by every party. Right? So, dominant caste numerically preponderant in that constituency, will be deciding the choice of the candidate. Caste arithmetic. So caste based politics, there is interest based politics, there is no ideology based politics. Who is a nationalist? The topic is on nationalism. The features of a nationalist. Who is a nationalist? Syllabus is nation, democracy, citizenship, paper 1 as well as paper 2. George Orwell says that a nationalist is one who thinks solely, mainly in terms of competitive prestige. His thoughts always turn on victories, defeats, triumphs, and humiliations. Right? So, a nationalist is one who always thinks about competitive prestige. My country will be kept on the upside, the adversary country will be kept on the downside. So, he constantly remembers about the defeats, the humiliations, the victories which his country has secured against an adversary. So, he is a nationalist. Constantly you have to think about the defeat of your country, the success of your country, the humiliation your country has faced. Then you are called as nationalist. So, who is a nationalist? George Orwell speaks about this. Endless rise and decline of great power units is what is contemporary history. A nationalist always will put his own side in the upside and the opponent side in the downside. So, upgrade, downgrade. What is nationalism today? For George Orwell, Islamism and Hindutva both are two different versions of nationalism. Right? So, nationalism is cultural. Nationalism, fascism, neoliberalism, Maoism, they are all related. Underlining fact is, you are conscious about your group. You have the feeling of togetherness and your mind will totally involve in thinking about your nation, its defeats, its humiliation and its victories. So, even religious nationalism is nationalism. In the 19th century, even before 19th century, the concept of nationalism emerged, especially the Jew people came, they created a nation. Savarkar, Jinnah, they also spoke about religious nations. So, attempts were made even before 19th century to create a nation. You create a nation to create a state, you create a state to create a nation. Nation means a strong feeling of oneness, state means a political unity. Nationalism, though started before 19th century, example the Jewish nationalism, by 19th and 20th century it started becoming a regular feature in many parts of the world. If you are a nation, you need a state. But if you are a state, you have to have a nation. So, nations will have to become a state. State will have to become nation. Then only nation state it can be. If you have a nation, you need to have a state. If you have a state, you have to become a nation. Nation here refers to the psychological unity. State refers to a territorial unity. For Orwell, nationalism always aspires towards a state, but nationalism can exist without a state. For example, Kurdistan. They have not created a state. But if they are coming together, all the Kurd people present in Iraq, Iran, they are scattered in different nations. They are scattered in different states. But if they can come together, they can. For example, Pakhtuns spread in Afghanistan and Pakistan. A nation can exist without state. A state also is existing without nation, India. India is a state without nation. Because you don't have a feeling of unity. But we are living within the territorial boundary. So nation can exist without state. And state can exist without nation. Even though, if you have nation, you have to become state. If you have state, you have to become nation. Islamic state is what? IS is what? Are they living in one place? No. IS is a nation only, no. Islamic state is a nation. Because they have a sense of unity. So they may call themselves as a state, but they are nation. Because they have a sense of unity. Are they present in one territory? Islamic state. They are spread in different parts of the world. So the difficulty in the study of nationalism is even terrorist groups will have to be called as nation. And terrorists should be called as patriot or nationalist. That is why it is very difficult for United Nations to make a consensus definition on terrorism. Who is a terrorist? Saudi Arabia says one thing. Pakistan says there are two terrorists. One is a good terrorist, another is a bad terrorist. And India says terrorist is a terrorist. We don't like to differentiate. Bhagat Singh was told as a terrorist by British. He became a national hero. Yasser Arafat was a terrorist. But he became the president of Palestinian Authority. So history shows how terrorists will become national leaders. And that is why it is very, very difficult to categorize a group as terrorist. It may be terrorist for you, but it is nation for them. All the terrorist groups, it may be Hezbollah, or it may be Boko Haram, or it may be Islamic State, or it may be even Al-Qaeda, or it may be even Taliban. So this is a very tricky question. Cannot decide, time will decide whether they are terrorist or they are nation actually. Islamic State is a nation for them. For the world, terrorist. Right? Next topic is on social movement. Actually, farmers movement, which became very, very vocal, very, very active since 2016. So, how farmers movement of the present time is different from the old movements? Dalit unrest. After which we will see the farmers movement. Dalit movement. Dalit consciousness is a very important question every year. There are two important uprisings. One is by OBC, another is by Dalits in Gujarat. Two unprecedented political mobilization in Gujarat 2016. One is the Patidars demanding reservation. Second is Dalit mobilization. They wanted social justice, they wanted cultural autonomy, they wanted a sustainable livelihood. So, Patidars asking for reservation is first unprecedented movement in Gujarat 2018, and the second is the Dalit consciousness asking for cultural autonomy, asking for a sustainable livelihood. many people came in support, and the movements today, it is embracing the entire community. It is not just the participants are only from a particular group of that particular caste. Rather, it is embracing the entire community. Large number of people participate. So that warranted a sociological scrutiny of the unprecedented movements, Dalit movements and reservation movement in Gujarat. Educated people, middle class people participated. So more educated middle class participants present, not from the lower caste per se, not from the poorest sections, not uneducated. Participants are diversified, educated, middle class, youths. Similarly, Dalit mobilization was also very spontaneous. Both the mobilizations, whether Patidar reservation or Dalit consciousness, more diversified participants, educated people, middle class people, youths, and it was very spontaneous. And there is no single organization which can say that we are the reason for the success of the people's mobilization. So why that spontaneity came? Many upper caste supported Patel's reservation movement. They gave material support. They gave human support. So Patidars got the support from all the upper caste. Similarly, Dalits were backed by OBCs, Muslims, and human rights groups. So, multifarious participants are present, youths are present, educated people are present, middle class people are present, and cutting across their caste identity, others have also supported. For example, Patel supported by upper caste, Dalits supported by OBCs, Muslims, and human rights groups. So, spontaneity is one thing, diversified participants another thing, support coming, cutting across their caste identity is another thing, and that is why it is important to be noted. Where it took place? These two unprecedented movements took place in Saurashtra region, and Saurashtra region was benefited by agricultural sector, dairy development. So, it was not basically poor. The movements took place in Saurashtra, which was benefiting from agricultural growth and dairy development. So, it is benefited by growth. 2017 August, Yuna agitation. The reason is, informal neoliberal political economy of Gujarat has resulted in revival of the traditional identity. So revival of your primordial identity because of the neoliberal economic reforms in Gujarat. On one hand, your primordial identity is glorified. At the same time, you are extending your network for support. So, you are developing social capital, extending your network. And the primordial identity is rejuvenated, it is revisited, it is revived because of the informalization of economy brought forward by neoliberal economic policies in Gujarat. As we know, capitalism leads to more and more informalization of work. Informalization of work, acceleration of primordial identity. At the same time, people are extending their mass base, developing social capital, by creating networks. That is why OBC, Muslim supported Dalits, human rights activists supported Dalits, upper caste supported Patels. A revival of cultural ethos, reinforcing the caste bonds, perpetuating social tension among the competing caste. There is a topic called as caste conflict in the 7th unit section C of paper 2. You can write this thing in caste conflict. Revival of identity, competition within the communities, perpetuating social tension. So, scheduled caste versus non-scheduled caste. Dalits have got educated today, so they are not ready for the old inequality. The growth of education and urban middle class among Dalits is not tolerated by non-Dalits. So the progress of Dalits not tolerated by non-Dalits, as a result of which Dalits versus non-Dalits conflict. The upward mobility of the Dalits, the assertivism of Dalits today, resulting in clash of identities, clash of communities. More and more they are becoming educated, more and more they are constituting political parties. So their assertivism resulting in the hitherto dominant caste waging a war against Dalits. Untouchability is practiced even today. SCs don't have access to burial ground in 96% of villages. They don't have access to grazing grounds, violation of class Article 15, violation of Article 15. No access to public places. 96% of villages, Dalits are not given burial ground. And untouchability practiced in the marketplace. Even for a government official or a doctor or a teacher from Dalits, it is very difficult for them to get a house for rented. So, the old idea about their caste obligation, a new found identity, the old perception plus new found identity, both in the minds of Dalits and non-Dalits, resulting in conflicts. Conflicting perceptions and practices between the perpetrators of violence and the victims of violence. Conflicting perceptions of the perpetrators and the victims of violence. So, new found identity, old identity. Conflicting between SC and non-SC, resulting in caste conflicts in Gujarat. Why there was an attack on the SC tanners in the Una incident? Because that is the only job available for them. And when the cow vigilantes are dictating an order, they are not able to follow the order, and that is why they are lynched. The resistance of SC tanners to the cow vigilance orders in case of Una is partly because they have no alternative source of livelihood. urban areas are also not free from caste based disabilities or atrocity. So untouchability is practiced even in urban area. The scheduled caste, they say that their colleagues are discriminating them after they came to know that they belong to Dalits community. So untouchability is not just practiced in cities, it is not just practiced in villages. Untouchability is practiced even in modern employments. A study says that in many of the IT industries, those belonging to former untouchable caste, they are not given higher positions even today. So IT industry is also practicing untouchability. They don't give managerial position, topmost positions to the individuals coming from lower caste, even in the private sector. Right? So this is the status of Dalits in India today. Right?